The following program is made possible by friends and partners of the Quick Study Television Ministry. Thank you for your support. The God of the Bible is a covenant God, means he doesn't break promises with individuals or with nations upon the earth. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. My name is Rod Hembry.
I'm Janice.
And I'm Corey.
This is the Quick Study Television Program, taking you through the Bible in 1 year from our headquarters at BibleDiscoveryTV.com. Today, as we go through the Bible, we're in the book of Isaiah. What a great prophet. And we learn about these steady or good and sure promises. If you've ever felt like God has broken a promise to you, stay there. We're going to talk about that and much more coming up in just a moment. But it's Friday, so it's Science Day. Here's Rye the Science Guy with Cosmic Mysteries.
Well, a little bit of astronomy history today. We're going to be looking at Pluto's discovery and the events surrounding it.
Surrounding Pluto and the events surrounding Pluto. Can you do better than that with Bible archaeology, Corey?
I am going to try. We are going to be taking a look at an ancient tomb in Jerusalem that directly ties into the book of Isaiah.
And there are a lot of ancient tombs in Jerusalem.
There are.
There's also the Bible Discovery TV Challenge,
yes,
which is
Isaiah 25 begins, O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name, for you have done wonderful things. Your counsels of old are righteous and just, faithfulness and truth, merciful and gracious.
All right, the counsels of old. I mean, it's all in today's reading. Let's study all.
Now, I want to explore with you some very fascinating finds from the cities of Jerusalem and ancient Lachish. They have to do with a man that is specifically mentioned in Isaiah chapter 22. His name is Shebna, steward over the king's house. In Isaiah chapter 22, Isaiah prophesied against Shebna, who held the position of steward in charge of the house. Shebna was in trouble because of his pride. Apparently, he had built himself a rock-cut tomb somewhere high in a hill or mountain and had paraded around in extravagant chariots. It was said that he would lose his job as servant over the palace and that Eliakim, son of Hilkiah, would take his place. Indeed, when 2 Kings chapter 18 lists the court officials of Hezekiah, it lists Eliakim as in charge of the palace and the demoted Shebna as court secretary. In the 1870s, Charles Clermont Gonneau excavated an ancient tomb carved into the rock of a cliff face that overlooked the ancient city of David. In it, he found an inscription that he sent to the British Museum, but it wasn't translated until over 80 years later. After translation and being dated to the time of Hezekiah, the inscription has almost universally been accepted as belonging to Shebna. This tomb is likely the one that got him chastised by Isaiah. But that's not all. Two seal impressions have been found that preserve a full version of Shebna's name, Shebnayahu. The first was found at Lachish. It was labeled a mystery because it was missing a chunk that would have held Shebna's position in the royal court. But a second impression was bought in 2007 that was identified as coming from the same seal. This time, a piece of the missing word was preserved, and it identifies the owner of the seal as a servant of the king, meaning an official. So, not only do we have two impressions from Shebna's seal, we also have his boastful rock-cut tomb.
Today, as we talk about good and sure promises, we are focused and forced into Isaiah 26. It is called the Song of Salvation, which brings glory and praise to God for his coming judgments. Now, chapter 27, verse 1 concludes the song with a stunning reality. What evil there is in the oceans of humanity will be struck down by the sword of heaven. It's a word picture. Isaiah continues his harsh and politically incorrect prophecies of truth with stunning precision. Now, chapter 27 continues in verse 2 with the unthinkable, the resurrection of ancient Israel into the times of the end. Now, this is an 8th century BC prophet, and this is happening in our midst today. The prophet's words read like the registers of modern history. We would be wise to pay attention to the Bible. Let's study on.
Isaiah 27, verses 1 through 13. In that day the Lord with his severe sword, great and strong, will punish Leviathan the fleeing serpent, Leviathan that twisted serpent, and he will slay the reptile that is in the sea. In that day sing to her, a vineyard of red wine, I the Lord keep it. I water it every moment, lest any hurt it, I keep it night and day. Fury is not in me. Who would set briars and thorns against me in battle? I would go through them, I would burn them together. Or let him take hold of my strength, that he may make peace with me, and he shall make peace with me. Those who come, he shall cause to take root in Jacob. Israel shall blossom and bud and fill the face of the world with fruit. Has he struck Israel as he struck those who struck him? Or has he been slain according to the slaughter of those who were slain by him? In measure, by sending it away, you contended with it. He removes it by his rough wind in the day of the east wind. Therefore, by this iniquity of Jacob will be covered, and this is all the fruit of taking away his sin. When he makes all the stones of the altar like chalk stones that are beaten to dust, wooden images and incense altars shall not stand. Yet the fortified city will be desolate, the habitation forsaken and left like a wilderness. There the calf will feed, and there it will lie down and consume its branches. When its boughs are withered, they will be broken off. The women come and set them on fire, for it is a people of no understanding. Therefore he who made them will not have mercy on them, and he who formed them will show them no favor. And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord will thresh from the channel of the river to the brook of Egypt, and you will be gathered one by one, O you children of Israel. So it shall be in that day. The great trumpet will be blown. They will come who are about to perish in the land of Assyria, and they who are outcasts in the land of Egypt, and shall worship the Lord in the holy mount at Jerusalem. Isaiah 27, verses 1 through 13.
There is a higher authority. There is a higher accountability. In the book of Isaiah, we've been reading about the day of the Lord. We continue reading about God's higher accountability. I want to jump right into the scripture today with Isaiah chapter 27. Here is what the Bible says. In that day, the Lord, with his severe sword, great and strong, will punish Leviathan. This is the creature representing the evil of man. The fleeting serpent, Leviathan, the twist the twisting serpent, and he shall slay the reptile in the sea. Beloved, I want you to know as we focus on the day of the Lord through Isaiah that all evil done upon the earth, past, present, and future, will be reckoned. No one will get away with anything. Hallelujah. God is a just God. And so as we jump right into the day of the Lord, when we talk about God's faithful and sure promises, he has a covenant to make the wrongs right. He has a covenant to bring justice. We then move to Isaiah chapter 27, verses 2 to 5. Here is what the great prophet says: in that day, sing to her a vineyard of red wine. I, the Lord, kept it. I watered it every moment. Wow, a remnant. God keeps his remnant. Lest anyone hurt it, I keep it night and day. Fury is not in me. Who would set briars and thorns against me in battle? I would go through them. I would burn them together. Or let him take hold of my strength, that he may have peace with me, and he shall make peace with me. I want to tell you something, and this is perhaps one of the greatest messages I could ever give you from the scripture. Judgment comes upon all, but those who have made peace with God through Jesus Christ are reconciled already because of the blood of Christ. You see, I want to remind you of something, that yes, the day of the Lord's coming, and yes, judgment comes and wrongs will be made right, but aren't you glad and grateful that God so loved the world that he gives his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life? I mean to tell you, is that not joy unspeakable or what? I need you to get a grip on this, because this is what the gospel message is all about. And so it says in this past scripture we just read, he will water it every day. That's the daily word of God going into our hearts as we encourage you to read daily here on Quick Study. What a prophetic statement. Oh, but wait, there's more. Here is the longest passage we're going to read today from Isaiah chapter 27, 6 to 13. It says, those who come, he shall cause to take root in Jacob. What? That's amazing. Israel shall blossom and bud and fill the face of the world with fruit. Has he struck Israel as he struck those who struck him? Or has he been slain according to the slaughter of those who slaughtered him and slain him in measure by sending it away? You contended with it. He removes it by his rough wind in the day of the east wind, a reference to the coming of Christ from the east. Therefore, by this, the iniquity of Jacob will be covered, and this is all the fruit taking away in his sin. And when he makes all the stones of the altar like the chalk stones that are beaten to dust, he fulfilled the perfect law, you see. Wooden images and incense and altars shall not stand. We worship a living God. Yet the fortified city shall be desolate, the habitation forsaken and left like a wilderness. There the calf will feed, and there it will lie down and consume its branches. But when its boughs are withered, they have broken off. The women come and they set them on fire, for it is the people of no understanding. Therefore, he who made them will not have mercy on them, and he who formed them will show them no favor. And it shall come to pass on that day that the Lord will thresh from the channel of the river to the brook of Egypt, and you will be gathered one by one, you children of Israel. Hallelujah. So it shall be in that day that the great trumpet will be blown, and they will come who are about to perish in the land of Assyria, and they who are outcast in the land of Egypt, and they shall worship the Lord at the holy mountain of Jerusalem. Beloved, God is a covenant God. He never abandons his covenant. He will never abandon those who rest, who have Shabbat in his covenant. Yeshua HaMashiach said, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden with your laws and your religion. He says, I will give you rest. I will give you Shabbat. It is in him that all the laws and the prophets were fulfilled. And he rescues those on the day of judgment. He gathers them, as we have read, one by one, individually. We've read today, he waters them, takes care of them. There is a remnant. Come to Jesus. The day is coming when he's coming to the earth. Come to Jesus today.
All you who labor and are heavy laden, who seek to have justice and purpose in your life, who seek to know why you were really created, come to Jesus. Come to Yeshua HaMashiach, and in his name, he will seal you and ready you for the day when he will come individually and pick you up out of the judgments of God. This is what the great prophet Isaiah is saying. Do you hear him today? Then pray and say, Jesus, I need you. Come into my heart. Come to Jesus today.
As we continue to study through the book of Isaiah, it's a big one. It has 66 chapters. So what I'd like to do with you is actually go back through the pages of history and track its progression from the time when Isaiah wrote it till today. Take a look. The book of Isaiah claims to be written by the prophet Isaiah during the reigns of four kings of Judah, beginning with the year King Uzziah died and ending some point during Hezekiah's reign. Hebrew tradition adds some interesting, though so far unverifiable, information about this prophet. The Bible tells us that he was the son of Amoz, and tradition tells us that Amoz was the brother of King Amaziah. That would mean that Isaiah and King Uzziah were cousins. If true, this would add an interesting clarification to 2 Chronicles 26 that credits Isaiah with writing an entire history of the reign of King Uzziah. This paints a picture of a man of royal blood occupying an official court position until his call to be a prophet at the end of his cousin's administration. The contents of the book of Isaiah are amazing. From historical events recorded to individuals mentioned, the history checks out. Many discoveries in archaeology have verified Isaiah's credibility as an historian. But there has been one argument that may never be solved definitively: the fight over authorship. The book itself, all biblical references, and all historic tradition name Isaiah as the singular author of the book of Isaiah. If you believe that there is a God who knows all things and speaks to men, then the whole book being credited to Isaiah makes perfect sense. However, if you're a skeptic, then there is no way you can accept Isaiah as author. He prophesies with exact detail events that happened hundreds of years after his life, so there must be another author. The problem with this view is that there is no evidence that supports it. Even when claims of evidence are made, those are easily explained to support the Isaiah as author theory.
Quick Study Television and Bible Discovery TV present The Psalms of Praise, Episode 2 with Janice Henry.
The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Day unto day utters speech, and night unto night reveals knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world.
Join Quick Study's Janice Hembry and musician Gene DeVries on keyboard as key selections from the Book of Psalms are presented in prayer and meditation form in this beautiful one-hour CD, designed especially for Quick Study partners and viewers.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits.
To receive your CD, call or write to P.O. Box 150, Murrysville, Pennsylvania, 15668-0150. In Canada and internationally, write to Quick Study, P.O. Box 456, Orangeville, Ontario, L9W5G2. We suggest a $10 donation above your regular monthly giving to keep Quick Study strong through the summer. You can also get it directly and download it at BibleDiscoveryTV.com.
Psalm 19 says, the heavens declare the glory of God. Here to help us see that glory is Ryan with Cosmic Mysteries.
What is Pluto? Is it a planet or not? Well, recently many have asked this question. Well, in this two-part series, we'll first be looking at the history surrounding Pluto's discovery and then talking about what Pluto's place is in our solar system.
In 1906, Percival Lowell, the founder of the Lowell Observatory in Arizona, began searching for a ninth planet in our solar system, which he called Planet X. He believed in Planet X's existence due to perceived irregularities in the motion of Uranus. He not only specified its location, but also predicted that Planet X was six times the mass of the Earth. However, despite his 11-year search, spanning from 1906 till his death in 1916, he was unsuccessful. In 1929, Clyde W. Tombaugh was hired by the Lowell Observatory, and in 1930 he discovered Planet X, close to where Lowell had suggested, by comparing photos of stars taken 2 weeks apart. This seemed to verify Lowell's predictions and therefore was officially announced on his birthday, March 13th. At the suggestion of Venetia Burney, an 11-year-old schoolgirl from Oxford, England, Planet X was officially named Pluto. Also interesting is that its first two letters are the initials of Percival Lowell. Percival Lowell was right about a ninth planet, but how close were his predictions? Because Pluto is 40 times more distant than the Earth is from the Sun, and can only be seen with the aid of a telescope, it has made it difficult to accurately determine its size and mass over the years. Astronomers were forced to use the indirect method of watching the deviations of Uranus and Neptune's orbits. Lowell's original estimate of Pluto's mass was quickly revised from six times the mass of the Earth down to just about three quarters that of Earth. Then in 1978, a man by the name of James Christie of the U.S. Naval Observatory found evidence that Pluto had a moon, now called Charon. Using photos, he was able to make estimates on the diameter of Charon's orbit and its orbital period. Using this data, astronomers were able to calculate Pluto's mass with much more confidence. Pluto is now commonly accepted as being only 1/500th the mass of the Earth. A planet with a mass this small could not possibly affect the orbits of Uranus and Neptune. This led astronomers to question whether there was another hidden planet affecting their orbits. So in 1983, astronomers scanned the entire sky with their infrared satellite, but found no hidden planets. So what was Lowell observing? Most in the scientific community believed that the irregularities in the motion of Uranus and Neptune were imaginary, and that Lowell's calculations were wrong, and that Tombaugh's discovery of Pluto was a coincidence. Whatever the case, Pluto's discovery has a very interesting history. And even since that time, many more discoveries have been made, including two additional moons in orbit around Pluto, called Nix and Hydra. With science rising up like never before, we have great reason to be excited, as there are undoubtedly many more discoveries yet to come, which will further uncover and showcase the handiwork of our Creator.
So today we went through the history of Pluto's discovery, but make sure to tune in next Friday when we discuss the official decisions made about the status of Pluto.
I can't wait to hear about the status of Pluto. Very, very important. It knows its place in the solar system. Mm-hmm. I still think Pluto's a planet, by the way. I'm not getting away from that. They want to downgrade it. I'm the pro-Pluto planet people. Anyway, if you want to get involved with the observatory and also get involved with some discussion and so on there, we have the online observatory, which is BibleDiscoveryTV.com. Click on TV channels and the Cosmic Mysteries channel, and click on the Cosmic Mysteries Bible Observatory, where we talk about stars and galaxies, planets and systems, aliens and demons. So that's all at our website, thebiblediscoverytv.com. Also, we have the BibleDiscoveryTV.com challenge,
yes,
question.
Yes, we do.
Which
yes.
is what?
Here it is. Isaiah 25 begins, O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name, for you have done wonderful things. Your counsels of old are righteous and just, faithfulness and truth, or merciful and gracious. What do you think?
I'm not sure, but I'm going to guess the first one.
All right.
With justice and
it's
in there.
Righteous and just.
Yes.
Sounds like it would fit better.
It does.
However, it's actually Isaiah 25 verse 1. It's faithfulness and truth.
Huh. That's really cool because that comes right after a bunch of prophetic judgments.
That's,
and
right.
That's really cool that yes. that's in there after mm-hmm. that to cap
there's
it
a,
off.
Yeah. There's a count, and I used to know it. I don't know about how many times faithfulness and truth shows up in cooperation with describing the character of mm-hmm. God as well. Mm-hmm. And it's very interesting, just like the Holy One of Israel mm-hmm. shows up over 30 times in Isaiah. So it's fascinating. Well, we want to encourage you to write to us with your prayer request as well. We have a segment on this program called Watch and Pray. Now, the reason it's there is just not for you to stare at the screen with a blank expression on your face, but to pray with these people, your brothers and sisters of mine who have written their prayer request to us. Thank you for joining us today on the Quick Study television program as we continue to go through the Bible in 1 year. I want to encourage you to keep reading with us. Now, why do we do that? Because the Word of God is different than any other book. I want to encourage you that Jesus Christ is the living Word. And Jesus Christ came to deal with the troubles in this world. The troubles were brought on by the first couple. And that first couple, Adam and Eve, in the garden chose to not go God's way. And we're living with the consequences of that now. In theology, we call that original sin. But there is a power above that. There is a way above that. You see, Jesus came and died on the cross and rose again to take away the power of that sin. That through Him, and by confession and profession of faith in Jesus Christ, we might have eternal life. And we might have the power to overcome. And that's really the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So I want you to be aware of that. Pray and come to Christ today. He is waiting for you. Okay, this is a good one, folks. Now, we are available on EyePoint TV application, on your smart TV sets, on your Roku set-top boxes. Yes, it's true. On your Western Digital, on your Boxy Box. We're making it real hard for you to avoid us, so check it out. That is Quick Study TV. And you can check that out at BibleDiscoveryTV.com.